Victoria by Stanley Weintraub. This book is read by Donada Peters. For Harry P. Clark, Bookman and Bibliophile. "I don't know what you mean by your way," said the Queen. "All the ways about here belong to me." Lewis Carroll, through the looking glass. Biographer's Preface. It has often been said that someone really worth writing about deserves reappraisal every 20 years. A new biography of someone as remarkable as Queen Victoria can be anticipated every decade as we perceive her anew. In our data-ravenous contemporary world, new lives of some figures, even trivial individuals by any historic measure, emerge nearly every year, often for no other reason than a ready market. Meanwhile, other potential subjects intimidate biographers into writing around their edges or into silence. Our sources of information about Queen Victoria have been considerably enriched since the early 1960s. New material has become accessible, such as Victoria's own album Consolatium, and we now know that she was not her father's first child, nor even his first Victoria. Vivid and colourful diaries, journals and letters of her relatives and her social and political confidants and acquaintances keep surfacing as scholars dig and estates are dispersed. And some revealing episodes in her life, neglected by earlier biographers because they were recorded in unlikely places, are available if one locates them. Medical knowledge affords us new insights, and former reticences about matters once deemed private or even unspeakable can be discarded. Reverence for the monarchy as an institution is now less of a barrier, although Victorian England itself was largely tolerant of its republicans and reformers. Also, concern for the pained sensitivities of living people whose close relatives even a generation ago had lived on the edges of Victoria's orbit has eased with time. This life adds still another perspective. It is by an American, although in terms of frequent residence and long affection, almost a London Yankee. Writing a life from the documentary richness available in Victoria's case requires the selection of details rather than the listing of them, the discarding of old shibboleths rather than their repetition, and the rejection of homely chance incidents that were often more comfortable than accurate. Thus, readers long immersed in Victoria's life and era will encounter here some unfamiliar names, as well as incidents unrecorded in earlier biographies. Errors of fact and of cause and effect, carried over from one earlier life of the Queen to another, have been amended for the most part silently, for biography is not an exercise in argument with predecessors whose labours have been so vital to one's own work. It is an attempt to inch ever closer to that elusive concept so lightly called truth. One can find different Victorias in many earlier lives, where the girl and the woman, the wife and the widow, the mother and the matriarch are concealed rather than revealed by the oft-told myths and legends that offer popular perception rather than private reality. Victoria was pleasant and unpleasant, selfish and selfless, democratic and dictatorial, heroic and humble, sophisticated and naive, energetic and slothful, passionate and passive, queenly yet middle class at heart. As a poet put it less accurately about himself, she contained multitudes. At the dawn of the modern age of machines and communications, a slip of a girl christened Alexandrina Victoria, 18 years old and in appearance hardly more than a child, became queen of her country. At the time of writing, nearly a century has passed since her diamond jubilee on the throne celebrated what appeared to be lasting imperial greatness, as well as the Queen's translation into almost mythic status. The Victorian age now requires a library rather than a book. Nevertheless, this volume attempts to explore, within one set of covers, the complex individual behind the statues, coins, stamps, portraits and place names, behind even the oft-misused adjective Victorian. Queen Victoria was one of the most scrupulously honest of human beings. I would like to think that she would find herself fairly returned to life in these pages. Although the fourth printing of the first edition included changes and updated information, and the first paperback reprint added a bit more, the inevitability for a biographer when his book is widely read is that publication elicits more than fan mail and crank mail. Sometimes one learns of slips to be corrected. Sometimes new information or misinformation arrives. Letters came from readers fascinated by their discovery here of an illegitimate half-sister to Victoria, who preceded her by 30 years, the product of her ducal father's wild oats. It proved to them that family legends about being related, however on the wrong side of the blanket, to the Queen must have been true. One reader even sent me a photograph of the tombstone in Ohio of a forebear described in the inscription as half-sister to Queen Victoria. All such retrospective sightings have been as historically authentic as the identity of the self-announced Dauphin in Mark Twain's Huckleberry Finn. I've even been invited by a venerable collector of Victorian memorabilia in London to see and to try on a Victorian nightgown of 1880s vintage in soft white lawn with her embroidered VRI monogram and a pair of her similarly embroidered undergarments. In the interest of biological research, I did examine, but eschewed donning the evidence, which confirms, as only a 47-inch waistband with drawstring can so dramatically do, that the Queen in her Jubilee heyday was of impressive girth for her barely 5 foot, if that, height. Further additions and revisions thus update this edition extensively and add to its accuracy. Whatever the changes, they confirm that Victoria, however fallible in small matters, was indeed a great lady. Stanley Weintraub, University Park, Pennsylvania, January 1996. Chapter 1. Jubilee, 1887. The Queen detested Buckingham Palace. Yet in December 1886, she had returned to the fogs and fumes of a London she loathed to receive a delegation of 200 peeresses of the realm on business related to her Jubilee. Little about Victoria resembled the engaging young girl of 18, whose accession nearly 50 years earlier would be celebrated across the breadth of the empire throughout 1887, and for which the visit of the ladies was preparation. Dressed in black, and in the fashion of 1861, as she had been since the death of the Prince Consort 25 years before, needing a walking stick to support her ample yet tiny frame, she might have been anyone's elderly, well-to-do grandmother. Only Buckingham Palace itself, and the small army of guards in bearskins and courtiers in velvet, suggested the Queen Empress. Some of the peeresses, on their way to the palace, may have seen hoardings that pleaded on behalf of Guy's Hospital. 200 beds closed for lack of funds, special appeal for £100,000. They had come representing a fundraising campaign from the women and girls of the United Kingdom as a mark of their loyal appreciation of Her Majesty's public and private character. The solicitation was to be extended to the colonies, as £75,000 had already been collected in the British Isles alone, in contributions ranging from one penny to £1 sterling. Now Victoria was herself invited to decide upon the form which the accumulated offering shall take. Other British ladies, some of them also peeresses, in a Jubilee presentation signed by 1,132,608 women of England, had a more specific purpose, urging the Queen to lessen want, strife and degradation, as well as the temptation to drink on the day of rest, by the Sunday closing of pubs. Such an appeal was hardly likely to enlist Victoria's support, for she preferred whisky to milk in her tea, and had little sympathy for Sabbatarian zeal. Nor was she interested in funding beds for Guy's Hospital. Perhaps she was unaware of the institution's plight, as she seldom ventured into the lower reaches of London and never read a newspaper. In any case, she had long made up her mind about the Jubilee largesse. The funds, she announced to the ladies at her audience, would be used to commission an equestrian statue of the late Prince Consort in Windsor Park. The number of statues of Prince Albert, in every conceivable posture from recumbent to equestrian, was already dismaying to those who perceived more urgent national needs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.